And let's pray. God, thank you for that great, great story, the old, old story, the story of your love. Thank you that it envelops our lives. Thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit, for the one who creates faith in us. But we thank you for all those who have shared that great story with us, that it might come to be our own. We thank you, God, that your story intersects with ours. And we thank you, God, that you fill us with your Holy Spirit, with faith, that we might also be witnesses to share that story with others. So be with us today as we hear your word, as we hear that story once again, that great story of how much you love us and the way in which you call us to do your will and your work in this world. Bless our time together in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, dear friends in Christ, grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, I want to start today by asking you a question. The question is this: how many of you ever get discouraged in your life? Raise your hand if you're ever discouraged. I think everybody's hand's going up. What gets you discouraged? Think about that. What is it that maybe gets you discouraged sometimes? You can shout it out if you want to. Anybody? Anything? Huh? Wind chill, okay, the wind chill, all right, the wind chill, it's going to get worse this week, right? Kind of gets you discouraged. We can clap for that. I heard somebody clapping. That gets us discouraged. What else? The Vikings, okay, the Vikings. They should be playing next week, right? 7-6-1 this season. That's discouraging. I was discouraged by that. What else?
Money problems.
Money problems, okay, finances get you discouraged. What did I hear back here? Politicians, okay, politicians, 35 days, was it, government shutdown, kind of discouraging. We got 3 weeks to go to see if they can come up with another way to kind of keep things going. Gets us discouraged, doesn't it? All kinds of things discourage us. Maybe there's an impasse in one of your relationships or problems at work or whatever it might be that get you down or get you discouraged. How about worry? Anybody here ever worry about anything? Raise your hand if you worry. I think we all have kind of worried, you know. I'm a Christian, and I'm a pastor, I'm a follower of Jesus, and I know that I admit readily that I worry sometimes, sometimes too much. What kinds of things do we worry about? Maybe our kids, no matter how young or how old they may be as parents or grandparents, sometimes you worry about them. Finances, we mentioned, health, too much hunger in our world, too much war going on in our world, lots to worry about. But you know, despite all of the things in our world today and in our lives that get us discouraged and that sometimes worry us, I'm convinced, and I know, and you know too, because it's given witness to us in Scripture, that God wants for us not lives that are overwhelmed with discouragement or worry, but rather God wants for us what the Bible calls a peace that passes all understanding. He wants a peace for us in our lives. And God wants a joy for us, a joy that is untouchable, I like to say, untouchable by the things of this world. Jesus talked about that in the Sermon on the Mount. Blessed are you, joyful will you be. There's an untouchable joy that God brings. So God wants for you and for me and for all of his people, peace that passes understanding, a joy that is untouchable by circumstances around us, and a hope and a confidence in the future as we move forward, knowing that God is already there and that God has us in his grip of grace and that he has us in the future. Do you think that's possible today with all the things that maybe discourage us or maybe worry us to really be filled with peace, joy, and hope from God? Raise your hand if you think that's possible. I think it's possible too. I think that there's a possibility, even amidst all that maybe is going on in life and in our world, to be filled with that. This past weekend, last weekend, was a weekend set aside to do some honoring and remembering of Martin Luther King Jr. I watched some video of him on YouTube. We looked up some of his prayers. You can Google Martin Luther King Jr. and read some of his prayers. You can read some of his speeches. He was certainly a flawed man in many ways, but he was a man who faced incredible obstacles. And he met resistance and discouragement in his life at every turn. And in his effort to bring about change through nonviolence, he and the others who were with him were met with violence and cruelty. And I thought, you know, as I was watching and reading, I thought, you know, if that were me, I would certainly be overwhelmed by discouragement and be filled with anxiety and worry. And I'm sure that Martin Luther King Jr. had times of worry and discouragement. But here was a man, a Baptist pastor, who also knew of God's love for him. And he knew of God's great calling in his life in a very deep and rich way, a very deep and rich relationship with God, which allowed him, despite the discouragement, despite the worry, to be filled with that kind of peace and that kind of joy and that kind of hope and confidence in the future. I want you to listen to a portion of the last speech that he ever gave, and I've shown this once before, but it seems like he knew that his life was going to be cut short by the violence that he was trying to do away with. I want you to listen to a portion of the last speech he ever gave. It was given on April 3rd, 1968 in Tennessee, and it's just one day before he was murdered and killed. Take a look.
Well, I don't know what will happen now. We've got some difficult days ahead. But it really doesn't matter with me now, because I've been to the mountaintop. I don't mind. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And he's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you. But I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.
You know, when you watch him or you read many of his writings, what I see is a man who was filled with peace that passes understanding, obstacles, despite worry. What I see is a man who's filled with joy, untouchable joy, and a man who's filled with a hope and a confidence for the future, even though he knew maybe he wouldn't get there, but he had hope that God was there in the future. What about Jesus? Do you think Jesus ever got discouraged? Do you think Jesus ever got worried about things? Think about Jesus and his life. As you read through Mark's gospel, we see pretty quickly that Jesus gets a lot of followers very fast. He calls his disciples, and then soon after that, he's preaching and teaching, the Bible says, with authority, and all the people are gathering around him. He's got a lot of people following him. But then when he begins to get detailed about his teachings, and he says things like, if you want to follow me, then you take up your cross and follow me. And he says things like, if you want to be great in this world, then you must be servant of all. And if you want to be first in this world, then you must be last of all. When Jesus started saying things like, take up your cross, sacrifice yourself for the sake of the kingdom, for the sake of love, for the sake of service, a lot of those people that were following him went away. They left him. They didn't want to follow him anymore. And I think Jesus must have been discouraged about that. A lot of people saying, no thanks, Jesus. I don't want to have anything to do with that kind of teaching. And you think about it, even at the end of his life, he was abandoned by his disciples, those closest friends, in the hour of his deepest need. And talk about worry. He knew that at the end of his life, he was going to be arrested, he was going to be beaten up, he was going to be treated cruelly, and he was going to finally be crucified on a cross. And the night before that happened, he was sweating drops of blood. He was anxious. So Jesus, too, faced some discouragement and faced some worry in his life. But you know what? What I notice as I read through the Gospel of Mark, and I encourage you to read through the whole Gospel in one sitting, read through all 16 chapters, what I notice is amidst the busyness, amidst the fast pace of Jesus' ministry, and amidst all that maybe could have overwhelmed him with discouragement and worry, I see a person, and Jesus was fully human, he was fully divine, but he was fully human, I see a person who was filled with a peace that passes understanding. And a joy that was untouchable by everything going on around him, and a hope and a confidence in God for the future. And I know that's what God wants for you as well. God wants you to have an abundant life, a life that is not overwhelmed by worry, not overwhelmed by discouragement, but rather is filled with that peace and with that hope and with that joy. Last week, I preached on the power of God being greater than the power of evil, the power of the devil. Did you know that one day the devil was having a yard sale out in front of his house? And all of the tools that the devil used were out there on display. The devil had all of his tools out there in his yard, tools like hatred and jealousy and dishonesty and deceit and selfishness. But then off to the side of the yard on display was a tool that was separate from the others, and it was more worn, it was more used than the other tools. And that tool was labeled discouragement, discouragement. And when a reporter questioned the devil about it, the devil said this, that discouragement is more useful to me than any other tool. When I can't bring down people with any of the rest of these tools, I use discouragement, because so very few people even realize that it belongs to me, and it's hard to recover from. I think discouragement in many ways is the opposite of joy. And do you know how Jesus overcame discouragement in his life? Do you know how he overcame anxiety and worry that might have overwhelmed him? He did it through prayer. He did it through prayer. We're talking about the way of Christ in the Gospel of Mark during these months. And one of the great things about Jesus, one of the ways of Christ, is the way of prayer. In our short reading today, Levi read, Jesus is extremely busy. He's fast-paced, but notice what he does. And Jesus does this over and over and over again. If you read through Mark, if you read through Matthew, if you read through Luke, if you read through John, you see it over and over again that Jesus would stop and he would pray. He would take time to talk with God, his Father, about what was going on. We heard read Mark chapter 1, verse 35. It says this, in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up. He went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. There he prayed. And again, we see that over and over again. So how's your prayer life these days? I can't emphasize enough the importance of taking time, really taking time, setting aside time, going off to a quiet place where you can be in conversation with God, where you can listen for God talking to you, where you can be alone and you can lift up whatever's on your heart, whatever's going on in this world, lift it up to God. Being quiet and listening. Think about all those, maybe you know people in your life, maybe you yourself, but I can come up with a lot of examples of people who have faced adversity, but also knew the peace of Christ that passes all understanding. Martin Luther King Jr., certainly we mentioned, has some great prayers, look them up. Martin Luther in the 16th century faced all kinds of adversity, his life was at stake. Do you know what Martin Luther would say? He said, when I had a particularly anxious day ahead of me, or when I had a particularly busy day ahead of me, he said, I would get up an hour or two earlier than normal, and I would spend those hours in prayer to prepare me for what God had for me that day. Or you can think of Dietrich Bonhoeffer during World War II, or Mary, the mother of Jesus, or you can think of Peter and the other apostles and Paul and his missionary journeys, all kinds of obstacles, all kinds of things to discourage him. But yet he spent time in prayer, and it helped him to overcome discouragement and worry. You and me, the same thing. Let's jump in and let's continue in prayer with Jesus as our model. Everybody breathe in for a minute. Just take a deep breath. Doesn't that feel good? Fresh air in your lungs. That's kind of like prayer. It kind of fills us up with God's Spirit, with God's Holy Spirit. It fills us up, and of course we can't keep it in there and hold our breath forever. It needs to come out. And that's what people like Martin Luther King Jr., they knew that peace that came from God, from prayer, from His Word. But then they were able to release it out into the world in service to the world. It kept them free from being overwhelmed by discouragement and worry. You see, prayer centers us. It centers you and me on the mission that God has for us. We breathe it in, God's love, that great, great story of God's love, and then we breathe it out in service to one another and to the kingdom of God. Have you heard the story about the businessman who ran into a friend of his? Friend of his was always worried about this, worried about that. In fact, his friend always had ulcers and high blood pressure, and they hadn't seen each other for a while. And when they bumped into each other, one of the man said, "How's your health?" And his friend said, "You know what? My health is great now. I've gotten rid of my ulcers. I've gotten rid of my worry. It's all gone." And his friend said, "How in the world did that happen?" He said, "Well, it's easy. I hired a professional worrier. I hired a professional worrier, and whenever something comes along that I need to worry about, I just tell him about it, and he does all of my worrying for me. It's awesome." And his friend, he couldn't believe it. He said, "That's incredible. I'd be interested in something like that. How do I get one of those professional worriers? How much does it cost?" His friend said, "Well, it's kind of expensive. He charges $100,000 a year." And his friend said, "How in the world can you afford $100,000 a year?" And his friend said, "I don't know, but I let him worry about it. I don't worry about it anymore." Well, in the same way, we have one who we can give all our worries to, and it doesn't cost a thing. In fact, it does cost something. It cost Jesus his life, but it's free for you and me. Jesus paid the price on the cross and in his resurrection for you and me to have abundant life. Your sins are forgiven. My sins are forgiven. We are in a right relationship with God, and God desires for us a peace that passes understanding, a joy that is untouchable, and a hope and confidence in the future. When I went away to college for the first time, I was excited about going away to college. I grew up in California, going all the way to the great state of Iowa, didn't know anybody. So I was excited, but I was a little bit worried. The same was true when I went to seminary. Excited, but a little bit worried. The same was true when I went off to Brazil on my internship. Didn't know anybody down there. Didn't speak the language. I was excited, but I was worried. When I got married, I was excited. Lori was worried, with a lot of good reason. When I went to my first congregation out of seminary, I was excited about that. I was a little worried as well. When I became a mission developer in Arizona, the same thing, excitement, but worried, would this thing take and get off the ground? When I came here to Sioux Falls, South Dakota, to Gloria Day, I was excited. I was a little worried, though. I thought, what are those people going to be like in South Dakota? How are they going to be? We're all prone to worry, right? It's a process, I think, to learn to trust God, to give God everything in prayer, to not worry so much. In all those instances in my life, and I know you can name instances in your life where the same is true, that when you pray, God provides answers. God provided what was needed. Two of my favorite Bible verses are found in Philippians chapter 4, Philippians 4 verses 6 and 7, where it says, and you know these, "Don't worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus our Lord." Did you hear that? The Bible says flat out, plain, that simply talking honestly and openly with God brings about a peace that passes all human understanding. Now, I know that prayer changes us. I can speak from experience that prayer changes us. I know that when we pray, we don't always get the answers that maybe we want. We don't always get the answers maybe that we expect. But I do know from experience, and I think you do too, that prayer changes us. It gives us that peace, that joy, that hope for the future. That God does answer prayer. Sometimes exactly as we want. Sometimes exactly as we think. But God answers prayer many times in different ways. But He brings about, as we are regular, constant in conversation with this God who loves us enough to give us His Son, it brings about a peace and a joy and a hope. It did that for Jesus, did that for Martin Luther King Jr., for so many others, it does the same for you and me. So in closing, hear this. Jesus died for you. Jesus was raised to new life for you. We celebrate every time we gather together the resurrection of Jesus. And Jesus calls you to serve. He loves you and calls you to serve, to go out in His name, making an impact for the kingdom of God in whatever ways that happens. That's your mission in general terms in this world. That's meaning for your life. God wants an abundant life for you. A life that is not overwhelmed by discouragement, a life that is not overwhelmed by worry, but rather, as we've said, a life filled with that peace that passes understanding, a joy that is untouchable, and a hope and confidence that God is there in your future. He's claimed you. He has you, no matter what. And that kind of life is lived out as we are constant and regular in prayer and talking and listening to this God who loves us so much. So, Gloria Day, pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing. Amen. Now may the peace of God, that peace which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.